Hello everybody, I am Advocate Vikrant Parashurami and I will be discussing a few aspects of the term lockdown, and this is the most apt time to discuss these different concepts and aspects, as there are certainly a number of doubts or questions which keep coming up when people are discussing about lockdowns. So to start with, first of all, discussing about lockdowns as a medium or as a method of fighting with this disease, experts across the globe have asserted that restricting movements and social distancing are the key to slowing the transmission of the disease. Therefore, several governments have put in place restrictions that will create circumstances necessary to ensure social distancing. Lockdown is one such restriction. Now, when we think about lockdown, many questions crop up in our mind. So today, I will try and answer some of those questions to the best of my capacity. So the first question that obviously would come to someone's mind is, what is lockdown? Now, Oxford Dictionary defines lockdown as an official order to control the movement of people or vehicles because of a dangerous situation. Going further, a lockdown is an emergency protocol that prevents people from leaving a given area. A full lockdown will mean you must stay where you are and not exit or enter a building or a given area. Under lockdown, people are required to stay indoors except if they are accessing essential services and commodities, such as, say, visiting a hospital or buying groceries. Now, the next question that would come to mind is there a legal framework at all to initiate such an action? And if there is, what is that? So, there is a legal framework. These restrictions on the movement derive their legal basis from Epidemic Diseases Act of 1897. So, when an epidemic rages, the state governments under Section 2 of the Act have the power to take special measures and prescribe regulations as to dangerous epidemic diseases. Also, Disaster Management Act of 2005 provides an administrative framework to take measures to deal with disaster. In this situation, once when the Home Ministry declares a particular outbreak as a notified disaster, it brings into play the provisions of Disaster Management Act. This further allows the National Executive Committee formed under the Act to give directions to the governments to take certain measures, and also could delegate powers to act under the said Act to the Union Health Secretary. It further allows usage of disaster funds created for this purpose. Other provisions under law which could be invoked are a question which could crop up in the minds of so many people, that it would make it necessary for me to discuss that aspect. So there are different provisions which can be invoked for better implementation or effective implementation of the lockdown. First is a provision which everyone will certainly know, Section 144 of the Criminal Procedure Code. It authorizes the magistrate of any state or territory to issue an order to prohibit the assembly of four or more people in an area. Further, provisions of the Indian Penal Code also help in effective implementation. So, invocation of the powers under Section 188 of the Indian Penal Code, whereby disobedience to the directions of the public servant is punishable with both imprisonment and fine. Section 269 of the Indian Penal Code can be invoked to ensure that nobody spreads infection of a dangerous disease. Further, Section 270 of the Indian Penal Code can be invoked if people malignantly fail to act during an epidemic. Once these provisions are invoked, the enforcement authorities may arrest the person involved. If someone tries to escape or escapes quarantine, the authorities may invoke provisions of Section 271 of the IPC. Now, who can initiate or enforce a lockdown is another question which could certainly crop up. So, a lockdown can be enforced by a collector or a chief medical officer in their particular area under the Epidemic Diseases Act of 1897. This gives them the power to restrict assembly of five or more people in close quarters. Now, the next question that could crop up is, what could be the general implications of a lockdown? So, in general, suspension of rail, air, and bus services along with public transport. Also, shutting down restaurants, cinema halls, shopping malls, gyms, swimming pools, and markets. Further, restrictions on vehicular movements. The next thing that could come up, or next doubt that could be there in the mind, is how is it different from a curfew? So, a lockdown is basically when there is a restriction on assembly, but essential services and emergency services are available. Next, Section 144 prohibits, under the Indian Penal Code, an assembly. So, a curfew is when essential services are shut in addition to the applicability of Section 144 of the Indian Penal Code. Now, the peculiarities of a lockdown are, you don't need a pass for movement. Further, essential services and emergency services are available. Thereafter, there is a list of exemptions and on applicability of the lockdown directions. Mass gatherings are prevented, and in case of a violation, there may be a legal action. Next question that would come up is, are there any exemptions or exceptions to the applicability of a lockdown? So yes, there are. And the essential services, emergency services, and media are generally the exceptions. Generally speaking, essential services like hospitals, banks, ATM, grocery stores, vegetable store, milk shops, etc. will be open. In the current scenario, in some areas, restaurants are also permitted to function with certain restrictions. There are no particular restrictions with respect to media. Now also, another aspect that could come in one's mind is, what are the do's and don'ts during a lockdown? So regarding the do's and don'ts during a lockdown, the government and the different authorities are from time to time issuing guidelines and directives, and the same need to be followed strictly. Now, thinking about whether any legal action or penalty in case of non-adherence to the restrictions would be attracted. So a legal action and penalty will both most certainly be attracted in case of non-adherence to the restrictions during a lockdown. And the same have been discussed earlier. But just in order to refresh the provisions wherein a penalty is mentioned, I would like to restate the provisions under which people could be penalized or punished. Section 144 of Criminal Procedure Code, Sections 188, 269, 270 and 271 of the Indian Penal Code. Also, people could be penalized or punished under the Epidemic Diseases Act and the Disaster Management Act. Finally, the most debatable issue is whether such a restriction affects our fundamental rights, the fundamental rights given to every citizen by the Indian Constitution. So all these restrictions, as discussed before, do impose certain restrictions on the free movement of the citizens and peaceful assembly. But the above restrictions have been imposed in order to maintain public order and in the interest of general public, and further for preventing danger to human life, health or safety, and to prevent disturbance of public tranquility. While discussing this issue, it will be very important to read the provisions of the Indian Constitution in the entirety, and it will be beneficial to understand that certain actions of the government and the authorities will fall under the category of reasonable restrictions, and certain other actions would fall under the category of category of procedure established by law. Thank you.